So Alex, I don't want to take away the time from you, but I would like to introduce yourself to our students, which will be great inspiration for many of them to be inspired to achieve greatness and really dare to dream, if I can use this word, to dare to dream, Alex. So inspire us all to dream big and, more importantly, step by step to make our dreams a reality. So my pleasure to introduce Aleksandr Yampolskiy, the COO of an amazing company.
Security Scorecard.
So tell us about yourself, your company, concepts of cybersecurity, and answer the questions.
Sure. So thank you very much for having me. Good Monday. It's a pleasure to kind of to meet all of you. So I'm an immigrant. I'm sure just like many people here, I immigrated from Moscow to New York when I was 14. Half of my relatives ended up moving to Israel and the other kind of half ended up moving to New York. And so, me and my family, when I was 14, we moved to New York. And I moved here at the age of 14. I didn't speak much English. So I arrived to New York. And before we moved to New York, it's all about imagination, right? But I imagined everything would be green, beautiful, manicured lawns, white picket fences. So we move on day one. I end up in a, up and coming neighborhood in Brooklyn, in a tiny apartment with my grandmother and me, my parents, myself. We're all in that apartment. We don't speak a word of English. We don't have much money. So literally on week one, we start walking outside on the streets of Brooklyn and picking up furniture from a garbage because we couldn't afford anything, right? But it was a big culture shock because especially like as an immigrant, you don't know anybody, you don't know what to expect, you don't have any friends. And I ended up going to Sinai Academy. I went into 11th grade and 12th grade. And it was actually an amazing time. It was really a great, amazing time for a couple of reasons. First of all, I managed to meet other people like me, right? Like I managed to meet other Jewish immigrants who went through the same type of a thing. And being able to be in that environment, I mean, many of these people are still my friends to today, years later. And secondly, coming from Moscow, I mean, we're Jewish, right? But we were growing up secular back in Moscow. It's not like exactly I knew about Jewish history or Hebrew or something like that. And so just establishing your sense of identity and your sense of heritage was very valuable and very important in this environment. And so I finished Sinai Academy, and I remember talking to a lot of my peers, and I was asking them, which college are you going to apply? And some people were saying to me, okay, I'm going to apply to Kingsborough. Some people are going to apply to Pace. I said, I'm going to get into MIT. And everybody started laughing at me. They're like, what are you doing? You barely speak a word of English. How are you going to apply to MIT? Like, they're never going to accept you. But I always believed that it's better to aim high and be able to fail very publicly. Like, even if people make fun of you after that, and you set high standards, high goals, and you aim high. And then even if you fail, you end up maybe getting into, like, your second and third choice. And I didn't speak much English. I had to take SATs, but back in life, I solved literally all my problems through hard work. So I picked up a dictionary, like literally I had a huge printed dictionary, English to Russian. And I started memorizing all the SAT words and using them in conversations, which made me look like a weirdo. I would talk to people and look at them and say, you look lugubrious. And people would look at me, you're like, what did you just say? I'm like, yeah, right here. It means sad. You look sad, lugubrious. They're like, such a word doesn't exist. But I pointed to them, didn't make a lot of friends as a result. But the important lesson is that almost anything, if you're determined enough and you want to put in the effort, the beauty of America, right? Like, lots of minuses, lots of pluses. But the beauty is that almost anything can be solved through hard work and perseverance, right? Like perseverance and hard work is probably 90% determinant factor of the success, maybe 80% of a success. The other 20% is being lucky. So I ended up getting into NYU for my undergraduate. And since early age, I knew that I was really passionate and I wanted to do computer security. I liked hacking. I liked the idea of figuring out how do you break into things? How do you make programs behave in ways that were not intended by their designers? So I was very lucky from early age to know what I'm passionate about and to pursue it. And that would be a big advice also to everyone. If there's something that you love, if there's something that you're passionate, go do it, because you're going to outwork anybody. If you love what you do, if you love what you study, what you do, it's not going to seem like work to you. You're going to study it on a weekend. You're going to study it on vacation. And so that's really the trick to being successful. So I went to NYU, I did computer science, mathematics. And after that, I wanted to continue learning as much as I could about cybersecurity. So I applied to graduate schools and I ended up doing my PhD in cryptography at Yale. I finished my doctorate. And afterwards, I had a choice. Do I stay in academia or do I go into industry? And academia was interesting, but I really like to build things from scratch. Like I really like to make things come to life. And so I ended up joining the industry. I ended up working in Microsoft, Oracle, building cybersecurity software for them. And then I joined Goldman Sachs. I was a team lead at Goldman Sachs, responsible for all of the authentications and entitlements. I was making a lot of money, but I was not exactly being very happy, right? Like I wanted to do something creative. I wanted to do something entrepreneurial. And so I got a call from a recruiter, and the recruiter said that I'm looking for like a lead security engineer at a startup called Gilt Groupe. It was a retail e-commerce startup, a couple of hundred people at the time. And as always, I had my kind of ambitions high. So I said, you know, I'm already like a team lead engineer in Goldman Sachs. I don't want to go join your company to be a lead security engineer, but I see you got a position of a chief security officer listed. Would you consider it for me? And I've never been a chief security officer before. But they said, okay, we're going to take a chance on you. Come over, talk to us. And I met with a team. I really liked the people, and they extended to me an offer. And I joined Gilt Groupe, which was a startup about 200 people, as a chief security officer. A couple of years later, when I left, they were close to 2,000 people. So we went from 200 to 2,000 people. And I learned a lot about cyber, about scale, about, you know, what it takes to really build a team. And again, after Gilt, I joined as a CTO in another startup, which did kind of online media, but I was really passionate about cybersecurity. So in 2013, I got together with my coworker back at Gilt, Sam. He was my kind of coworker. We built a team together and we started brainstorming about different type of ideas, different type of problems that we encountered back at Gilt Groupe. And so one of the problems that we encountered is that chief information officers are investing a lot of money into different type of cybersecurity solutions. But if you ask them, all this money that you invest, is it paying off? Is it actually making you more secure? They don't know how to quantify risk. And furthermore, as the market moves to the cloud, we'll become interconnected to each other. For example, we're speaking to each other on Zoom. Afterwards, you might use Dropbox to upload files. You might log into Facebook to send messages. You might use LinkedIn to create a professional connection. How do you know that all these different companies are actually protecting your data? The answer is there was no way to do it. And we came up with an idea that there has to be a way to measure and quantify risk, that there has to be a way to pick up enough data points and information about any company in the world and give it a score, a security score, a letter grade, A, B, C, D, F, just like in school, that represents how good security hygiene of a company is. And so we started incubating this idea back in 2013 and managed to raise venture capital for the idea back in beginning of 2014. And now, kind of fast forward 7 years into the future, 7 years into today, the company is about 300 employees, headquartered in New York. We have over 1,400 customers. We valued at close to $1 billion in valuation. We raised almost $300 million from different type of investors like Sequoia Capital, Google, and we're only really creating the story. The best is yet to come. So that's kind of like I gave a very high level story of an entrepreneurial journey, And I'm happy to go into like any specific details that Rebecca and maybe you want me to answer.
I'm gonna just maybe take from here, and I would love to ask our students to continue. I do know you and your story, and I'm really fascinated by the fact that you came as a poor immigrant, basically collecting the furniture from the garbage. And today your company is worth $1 billion. That is an amazing American dream. And really you need to aim high, number one, and hard work that you spoke is very, very important. So I definitely appreciate your message. At the same time, it's of course creativity and courage. You made a choice and you decided to move forward in life. That's number one I wanted you to comment on. How did you decide and to move from being employed and take a risk and start your own company?
Yeah, look, I think in life, taking risks, but taking smart risks, right? Taking calculated risks is really important, I think, for anybody who is an entrepreneur or anybody who wants to try to do it. So it was a lot of conversations with myself, right? In order to convince yourself to go do something and to take a risk, ultimately, the hardest person to convince yourself is you. Honestly, after you come as an immigrant to a country and you have to prove yourself completely from scratch, you know, you don't have connections, you don't have money. Anything you do in life, honestly, is not scary after it, because you try it, you fail. You still have your smarts, you still have your experience. You can go prove to yourself, right? So to me, a lot of the decisions I made were, I did not want to be in a position where 5 years from today, I'm going to look back and say, what would have happened to my life if I tried it, right? Like, I didn't want to be in a position where I regret something. Maybe I try it and I don't like it, but at least I know I did it. And so, for example, I knew that if I didn't try to start a company, I would regret it. I wasn't sure if it would succeed. I mean, honestly, statistically speaking, when you start a company, like 99.9% of a companies fail and they never raise financing. And I told to myself, look, if I try it and it fails, I'm gonna go get another job, right? Like, but if I don't try it and I'm just gonna go get another job working for somebody, I'm always going to regret wondering what is it going to be, right? And so that's honestly how I approach life, right? Like, you try it, and sometimes you fail. And the same, like, honestly, the same applies to almost anything in life, right? Like, you want to apply to a college, but you're afraid that you're gonna fail. Okay, like, just try it. You fail, you go somewhere else. Or maybe you're considering moving to Israel, for example, but you're afraid, right? Like, try it, right? Like, you know, maybe it's going to be amazing, but you're not gonna know what you miss until you actually take a risk and until you try something, right? Like, you don't want to live your life with regrets. You want to feel like you are trying new things and challenging yourself to grow.
Thank you so much. My last question I really want to open for everybody is actually borrowed from your conversation or interview that we had previously about comparing military and cybersecurity, because it is a battlefield. And I remember that you compared, I would compare like a missile and a tank. What is stronger? The defense mechanisms of the tank, the steel of the tank, so to speak, броня по-русски, right? Or снаряд, the missile. What is stronger? And usually, actually, the missile is stronger over time. It seems like the hacker or the cybersecurity, the hackers are usually ahead of the time in general. I don't know if you'll agree with that or not. But in terms of your cybersecurity principles and ideas, to be strong and robust like a tank, or to be resilient, if you can comment on that.
No, that's a good question. Indeed, we talked about it before. So there's a good book, actually, that General Stanley McChrystal wrote called Team of Teams, about collaboration and just teams and teamwork. And so he used the concept of robustness versus resilience, which I think is very applicable in cybersecurity. So when you think about robustness, that's how cybersecurity has been traditionally approached. They did something called the defense in depth approach, where you put a layer after a layer after a layer of security. So you make it almost impossible for the hacker, for the adversary to break into your company. So the reality is, in today's warfare and modern warfare, it's impossible, because with enough effort, the adversary is almost always going to succeed. If you have a nation state like China, they have unlimited resources. They can hack into any government organization, into any company. It's impossible to prevent it. So instead, we need to adopt the resilience mindset. And the basic idea is that you assume that things are going to get wrong. You assume that somebody is going to hack. And then how do you make it as easy to recover from this as possible? How do you design an environment to be as resilient as possible? And by the way, right, the same actually applies to people, to entrepreneurs, to students. You can go try to prevent every single thing from happening in your life, right? The robustness approach. The reality is, it's impossible. There's going to be things that go well, and there's going to be things that you don't expect. And you're almost always going to fail. You're better off building this resilience mindset, which really allows you to deal with the uncertainty when the uncertainty arises. And then the more equipped, the better you are to do it, the more successful you're going to be.
Hey, Alexi, I have a question. My name is Yuval Shal. I'm an engineer at Amazon. It's great to hear about your accomplishments. I had a question about when you told your story on how you went to do your PhD in cybersecurity. Like, academics and the corporate world are like complete 180, right? And so was there anything in your thesis or while you were doing your PhD that kind of drove you to go to a corporate environment or even a startup environment? Or, I mean, do you relate any of that to your thesis?
Yeah, look, I mean, my PhD was around cybersecurity, right? Like, it was in cryptography. It was, if you really want to get technical, it was application of certain type of elliptical curve cryptography to create mechanisms for distributed computing, right? So actually, some of the techniques actually used in blockchain and cryptocurrency were what I used. But I think when I decided to go from academia to industry, or just like whatever you decide in life, I think it's very important to know what you like and what you don't like, right? Like, what are the things in life that you enjoy and what you don't enjoy? And everything is individual for people. So for example, for me, what did I know when I finished my PhD? I knew that I don't want to just publish articles. Like, I knew that I wanted to build things that are going to be used by actual people. I didn't want to just publish papers. So that was like one important consideration. You know, the other part I knew is that I like to be the best at what I do, right? And statistically, if I looked at the academia, there's only so many professor positions open every year in the United States. And you know, I had good articles, but I didn't think that I had the best articles in the world. So I said, you know what? I can stay in academia and I can be an average guy amongst really smart guys, or I can go into industry and I'll be the smartest guy amongst dumb guys. So that was at least the thinking that I did back then. I mean, of course, I was completely wrong, right? Like, success in industry is not just about how smart you are, but it's more about how do you work with people? How do you convince people to follow you? What are your team skills? But at the time, I did not know it. So at the time, I made my decision to go into industry. And then I spent a number of years working at big companies like Oracle and Goldman. And I realized that I'm too opinionated to have people tell me what to do, right? Like I always felt like there are too many rules and policies for sake of policies and rules, which is normal. As companies become bigger, you have to have all this rigor and all these processes, but I really wanted to feel like I want to do something of my own and not as constrained by being part of a big company, right? So that was kind of my line of thinking that drove me to that. And everybody chooses their own path ultimately.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that makes sense. And I'm sure like a company like yours probably produces a lot of patents. Are there any that you'd be able to like link to us after this?
Yeah, I mean, look, we published over 23 patents, right? Like on what we do. I mean, you can go to our website or kind of Google for some patents. But look, again, patents and all this other stuff, ultimately in the end, it doesn't matter. What matters is what value do you really deliver through your product to customers, right? Like that's actually the Amazon mentality, right? Like customer first mentality. That's what Jeff Bezos advocated, that the most important chair in the room is an empty chair. It's not my opinion, but it's the empty chair represented by the customer. And so I would say, look, yeah, we have 23 patents and we're publishing more, but all of that is irrelevant. What matters is, are we delivering value for our customers? That's what matters. All right. Any other questions I can answer?
Hey, Alexi, my name is Arthur. I work at Datadog, which is, as you may know, an IT infrastructure monitoring. We have a security platform as well. So thank you for taking the time, getting on with us and telling us about your story. And congratulations on your most recent funding round. I read in the Forbes article, a couple of weeks ago, that you guys are looking at IPO in the next couple of years. What are the next stages for your company internally in terms of growing your customer base, growing your recurring revenue as you, look to IPO? And sorry for the investor-like question, but.
I like those questions. I didn't expect questions like that. Rabbi, you did not tell me you assembled such an expert audience. So by the way, you got a great company, right? Like Datadog is a great company. I met your CEO Olivier at a dinner. I got invited somehow to a dinner of French entrepreneurs. I don't know how they figured out that I'm French, but somehow I got invited. So we built a software as a service platform where you can type a name of any company and it gives you a score. It gives you analytics about how to improve a score. There are three use cases. The beachhead market for us has been supplier risk management, where companies use us to rate their suppliers, partners, prioritize it. The second use case has been board level reporting, where companies use us to report to the board. And a third use case has been cyber insurance underwriting, where companies use us to make underwriting decisions when they issue cyber insurance. So we are growing rapidly. We have two products. One of them is a security scorecard platform, which provides outside-in ratings. The other is the inside-out component called Atlas that allows the rated companies to provide their own information about their own cybersecurity hygiene and cybersecurity posture. We're going to be, I don't want to disclose too much because it's a public forum. But at a high level, we're going to be launching additional products on top of our platform to cross-sell, upsell into our customer base. We're continuing to deliver value to our existing customers by improving the product. For example, we integrated into over 30 different technologies, ServiceNow, Splunk, Archer. We're planning to continue to invest in those integrations because you need to be at a center of an ecosystem for CIOs and CISOs. That would be some of the key things. Continued growth being embedded in the ecosystem where people embed our ratings. From what we've released publicly, for example, we announced a partnership with Fitch Ratings. There's more partnerships on the horizon. We're working with Exiger to deliver it to Department of Defense. So we're continuing to heavily invest into our product, lock up these partnerships. That's kind of the things I can disclose publicly at least.
Alex, I want to thank you so much. I think that our time is finished because we have other rabbis. I want to thank you, and I also want to congratulate you, and everyone should know that your company was named the pioneer in technology by the World Economic Forum of Zurich. Am I right?
That's correct, yes.
which really means that you're a revolutionary innovator in the way in the world of technology. And I want to tell you that RAGE is in a way revolutionary in the field of education, especially of the young Russian Jews and the American Jews, you know, young generation. And we also integrate some technology ideas. So I'm looking forward actually to speaking with you about how can we make this startup RAGE to deliver value to the customer. And I'm in the empty chair of those who did not join yet our educational programs. I want to thank you, Alex. We'll be in touch.
Thank you very much, Rabbi.
Rabbi Goldstein and everybody. Thank you. Look at these amazing people. We have Rabbi Akiva Palak from Philadelphia, Rabbi Lindenbaum, also from Philadelphia, right? We have Rabbi Haran from Maryland. So this is a startup, Alex, which is unbelievable. I want to thank you all again. All the best.
Thank you, Rabbi.
Thank you. Thank you, Adina. Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you all guys for being with us tonight. For me, it was very personal because such a pleasure seeing Alex, who I know for at least 25 years.